Hi, welcome back to Doom Mixtape. I haven't done these for a while, and I was pretty sure that I wanted to stop doing them, but there are a few maps and things that I haven't looked at that I really wanted to look at, and this is one of them. And I just moved, and I didn't have a good setup for it for a long time, for like 2 months. So, yeah, now that I have the setup again, I'm kind of interested in looking back at some stuff. But yeah, this map is called Controlled System. It's map 13 of Sacrament.wad, which was made by the Russian Doom community, formerly Clan BOS. I think this is from 2011, and ALT is from 2012. This is the last map of the set. It's only 13 maps, and there's kind of more emphasis on mood. The music is MP3s, and not the usual MIDI. And there's a lot of just atmosphere in this level. It's a really big open level. This is just the intro area. A lot of interesting design and stuff to talk about. I was actually going to do annotated playthrough, but that takes a lot of work. And I guess part of the appeal of the Doom Mixtape videos is my rambling, even if I feel extremely self-conscious about that, so I might as well continue to subject myself to this. But yeah, I don't know. This was one of the big ones that I wanted to do a video for a long time, but I wanted to save it to the end. And I don't know, it's a really big map, so that I think I just didn't want to have to play through it a billion times. Of course, like, this map isn't too hard, or most of the maps in the set also aren't too hard on a pistol start, but or aren't too hard in general, but they have some annoyances with the pistol start, and this beginning part is one of them, like fighting all these things. If I had just, like, I don't know, they actually gave the super shotgun in this level, which they don't. I haven't found the super shotgun. It might be in a secret. So I play the whole level without one, which in Doom 2 is a big thing. There is, I do find a rocket launcher pretty early on, and a plasma gun, so it's not too bad. But this beginning part takes forever for me to get past just because of that. There's this, like, I don't know, this is a really straightforward, kind of goofy thing to do, but I like the layered rooms here. It's like, this is like some kind of machine room area that you're kind of activating an elevator or some sort of machine that lets you get through to the rest of the area, which is a big mass of ruins. And I guess, I don't know exactly what the name means, but my guess is, like, I think here I'm deciding whether I want to reload or start over. So it's a big mass of ruins, and I think the name, maybe, I don't know, it could just be poorly translated or whatever, but my interpretation of it is it's saying that the area is, like, secured or something, like it's under control, and, like, you have to get a bunch of keys to go back to this central, like, teleporter area, which is actually the author, whose name is B-Wen, also Lestat. I don't know if that's his, like, alternate name, but he did this map for Sacrament and a couple maps for Alt. One of which I think I'm going to do a video about right after this one. Because I really like it and it has some similarities. But the central teleporter thing is... No, he did three maps for Alt, sorry. The two secret maps and one of the normal maps. But one of the secret maps in Alt has the central teleporter thing from this map, so some thematic continuity. But yeah, I don't know. I see a lot of the maps in Sacrament have interesting. They're very very dark, a lot of them, and kind of disturbing. And this one is really the one that exemplifies it the most. But there isn't like it doesn't have the consistent kind of narrative that keeps it going like Alt does, which is kind of why I like that one so much, because it never completely runs out of steam. Like when you think it's starting to run out of steam, it there's a bunch of cool maps all at once towards the end. So yeah, and Azamail, who made a bunch of the maps in Alt, made a couple of the maps in Sacrament, which are more, they're not super difficult, but they're similar in terms of layout, a bit really aesthetically pretty. A lot of the maps in this set are very pretty aesthetically, but maybe not as developed in terms of like the gameplay or whatever. Although there are a lot of cool secrets and interactions, and it's definitely worth checking them out. And this set in general, even if it's a little inconsistent. It's the same with Alt, though. And the Russian Doom community is still making stuff. There was a recent release by them that was sort of remake of Doom 2 in name only, which is the project that like I started and was kind of ill-fated. A lot of people didn't like it. I didn't have anything to do with it after a certain point because I was kind of didn't know how to run the project and didn't know how to say no to people, I guess. Be better about that now, I think. I think the main thing is like I should have made it very abundantly clear that I didn't want the maps to be like in the original style. I just wanted them to be based off of the names of the original maps. Whereas, you know, a lot of people made maps kind of in the original style, and that was the problem with using the original textures and vanilla limitations. But in the Doom 2 and name only Russian Doom community remake, which is just like, I think it's like 10 levels. I don't know how many. Maybe it's like 8 levels. They do custom textures and it's limit removing ports. And I think that was a good call. There's some cool maps in it. I haven't played all of them, so I can't really say anything about it. But it's a recent release, and the guy who made this map... I shouldn't presume gender, but the person who made this map also made several maps in that, so definitely worth checking out. And it's good to know that these people are still making maps, even though Azamail hasn't seemed to make any maps or anything since then. But yeah, the controlled system, this part makes me think of it, like where you're unlocking the elevator down to this area to explore it. Like this ruins area has been like secured, but it's very or maybe it's like an ironic name because the area is just totally falling apart. It's like there's a huge, it's super dark, there's these huge bright lava canyons, and a lot of huge structures. This map is definitely very impressive for almost all stock textures, and really uses the lighting and just the textures combinations really well. Actually, there's a post that I wanted to read. There was a playthrough of Sacrament on the Doomworld forum, and this person, Demon of the Well, made an interesting post about this map. I apologized for the chain gun sound. Some of the custom sounds in this set leave something to be desired. Although I love the custom music, especially in this map, it fits this map perfectly. Okay. This is from Demon of the Well. I adore this map. Its setting is wonderfully realized, a real testament to the untapped potential for creating very pronounced atmospheres that the old stock Doom 2 textures still have even after all these years. Apart from the Blood Moon Sky, a few tree sprites, and some of that infamous TNT IV'd barbed wire mid-texture, controlled system is created entirely out of stock textures, and is one of the most thematically memorable maps from its year of release. It depicts the ruins of some fairly anonymous man-made structures, perhaps on the outskirts of a fallen city. There's a power station, part of what seems to be some kind of mining or shipping operation, a crumbling cathedral or temple of some sort, which is... it's probably my favorite area, just off the cuff. An observation deck, and more. All connected by an unusual system of transit bridges and skywalks centered around a modest open-air junction. All of this mass of man-made dereliction has been devastated by a series of cataclysms. Looks like somebody hit the Theosaurus. The land around it has been variously torn by earthquakes and scorched by great rivers of molten lava. The countryside is little more than a silent desert of ash, bereft of life, either animal or vegetable. Like the rest of Sacrament, the scene takes place at night under an evil-looking red moon, and Biwen has taken that notion that it's nighttime pretty seriously, as most of the landscape is swathed in a blanket of darkness and moonshadow, with only the illumination of the lava flows and a few parts of the human structures that still have power standing out against the rest of the scene in stark contrast. It really is brilliant, I think. This map is quite expansive, but deceptively so at first glance. Okay, so here I passed the central area. You saw the central teleporter, and this is one of the branches of the main path. I like how the light shadow like peeks out, and this is like some weird little library. This is the only area that's themed at all like this in this map, but I kind of like it. Anyway, early on in the power station segment, the environment is mostly small scale and claustrophobic. You just saw that part. And the progression is highly linear, which only emphasizes the sense of space and exploratory progression style that comes to the fore once you hit the meat of the map, which is when I went down the elevator and saw that central teleporter thing locked off. While the overall course to the exit remains fairly linear, it's not straightforward in nature, and there are all manner of optional things to see and do, particularly if you go secret hunting, which I missed most of the secrets in this, unfortunately. But it's long enough as it is. But yeah, it creates the impression of a decidedly open world. And then he talks about the monster count, which, whatever. You're just saying that the monsters are placed. There's an area that I'm about to pass here where there's lost souls, and they're not harmful to you, but they serve a thematic purpose. I love the lighting in these hallways, by the way. I'm gonna like not go in there because I don't need to go in there right now, but you can see the lost souls on the side there, and I think I passed by some earlier. But yeah, the progression is actually pretty linear, and I had played through the map right before recording this, so I knew pretty much where to go. Although I still got lost a few times, because it is a pretty confusing map. But I had to play this map a lot. I think on the right there are some lost souls if I look at them. Yeah, there you go. There's like some hung corpses or something. I think that's cool. You don't actually go to that area, so it's just there to be something that you see through the bars, which is like, makes me think of, there's something in the Doom 1 map, House of Pain, That's kind of like that, like a torture chamber. Maybe you do actually go there. There might be a secret there that I missed. But I don't go there in this playthrough anyway. Yeah, this was quite a chore to get through, but I'm really glad that I did it. Felt like getting a monkey off my back or something. But yeah, to finish up Demon of the Wells description, which I think is partly what convinced me to do a video of this particular level. He says one of the most basic elements of Doom 2's diegesis is that the Earth has been besieged and ruined by darkness. There are so many different ways to play this off, from the decidedly tongue-in-cheek to the deadly serious. But whatever choice an author takes, if she or he really takes one at all, regarding this element of the setting, we typically see the Earth in the process of being conquered, or immediately afterwards, like in Doom 2, the setting is like the Earth is being conquered, and there's sort of ruins and whatever, but it's not completely derelict. But in this map, controlled system, it feels like something out of a timeline where the planet has fallen and is simply never rescued. A snapshot of what the world looks like years and years after becoming a suburb of Tartarus. For a game as simple as Doom is, the mood here is surprisingly poignant, and for that, this WOD is worth for this map alone. Yeah, I like these burned out vine wires. It makes me think of, I don't know, like No Man's Land or something like that. This is, I think this is like, seems to be a theme across like Russian media, Russian art and Russian video games, like these kind of themes, like blown out post-apocalyptic, not even necessarily, it's might be reductive to call it post-apocalyptic, but like burned out landscape, kind of natural and man-made elements being kind of indistinguishable from each other. These like structures being mixed with like really kind of surreal, almost like religiously tinged imagery. I just thinking of like, I don't know, like some of the Ice Pick Lodge games, which are Ice Pick Lodge is a Russian game studio. I haven't really played. I only played a tiny bit of like The Void and Pathologic. Ooh, video error there. Weird. I don't know what that's about. I guess I was having frame rate problems or something. Yeah, there's just a, I don't know what it is with me and Russian art in general. Like when I saw Tarkovsky, I took a Russian film class kind of just by coincidence. And that was the first film class that I took, and especially like Tarkovsky, some of the imagery and stuff just really resonated with me, and I continually feel that way about a lot of like Russian video games that I see, like the Stalker series, Ice Pick Lodge, this game called Vangers, which is totally bizarre. Some of these Russian Doom WODs. There's this guy, Vasily Zotov, who is apparently schizophrenic, who makes these very bizarre, more or less broken games that I still think are really beautiful. I think, like, there's just a design sensibility that you don't see. It's, I was talking to somebody else about this, but in the Doom community, like a lot of modding communities, or at least creative ones, there's a lot of people who want to make the biggest and the best thing and the hardest thing. So that's really big. You know, that's a really big thing, slaughter maps and maps that are really, really hard and made for like a small group of people trying to kind of one-up each other with bigness. But then there's also like a group of people who kind of are more what you would consider along the lines of like modern game designers, who really believe that maps should be streamlined and should flow well, and it's the same kind of arguments that you would see in like level design, you know, pro level designers making basically. But and so like things like these maps, they're not necessarily streamlined. I think this map, the scenarios aren't based around the combat for the most part. But I actually think, you know, the combat is pretty good. There are some very cryptic and, you know, annoying navigation decisions and stuff. But the thing is, like, that's so much of the mood. Like these spider mastermind, these spider, whatever they're called, forget their fucking name. These spider guys being right there is like, I don't know, kind of colors the world or something. Like it's part of the texture of the place rather than just being mostly combat oriented. And I don't know, somebody, what's his name? Kmexi. The guy who runs, the person who runs, I'm not gonna presume gender. God damn it, fucking Revenant Rockets. The person who runs the Doom. Oh yeah, well, it's called One Man Doom blog, so presumably Mexi is a guy. But anyway, the One Man Doom blog that he plays through a bunch of different Doom mods and reviews them. He said that he called it Russian realism, where a lot of the environments are designed like actual environments, and you wander around, and there's more of a interest in the environment being coherent rather than being more abstractly put together based around gameplay. And I think, yeah, you can definitely see that difference. It might be slightly reductive, but it's a general principle that is true. And I think you see that a lot in a map like this. Here I like that this connects back up to the central area. But there's a lot of like side paths and just winding passageways and stuff. A lot of the rock textures and everything are used really well here. But this map, when I first played it, or for a long time really, felt like kind of a monolith, partly because it was so dark, and it was hard for me to figure out exactly where I needed to go. It's the same with like the first map of or the second map of Sacrament, which is by Lanos, who is known for making really big open maps. And that's like, that map is just like a giant city, and there's almost no combat. You just wander around. It's kind of nice feeling, but it's not easy to navigate. This has a little bit more like constructed gameplay direction in it, so kind of, yeah, more oriented towards that. But I wanted to compare and contrast this map to map 23 of Alts, which is also by Bwin and also has a main hub area, but is more tight and compact just because I think that map is really interesting as well, and it's not nearly as thematically big, I guess, or it's thematically coherent. It's not as like pretty or unique, but in terms of the design, I think I might even like it a little bit better. I don't know. Maybe it's just that it ties into the narrative of Alt, which is what I like. But yeah, I did want to say about the abstract. I'm not gonna put this up against my face. I'm talking about the microphone. I did want to get a microphone stand for this, because this is like, I got this vocal microphone recently, and someone gave it to me. Well, we'll just say that someone gave it to me. it was handed down to me. But I wanted to get a microphone stand so I can stream and everything, so stay tuned for that. I did try and stream Bauhaus.wad, which is like a few levels made by this guy who also made a set called Monster Hunter, and it's in the attempting the Bauhaus architectural style in a Doom wad, so that's pretty interesting. But I had problems with the frame rate and my microphone. I have a headset microphone that I got, but it's not very good, so I just rather use this like actual real vocal microphone and have a mic stand instead. But the thing that I wanted to say about streamlined maps is, I don't know, I mean I certainly get insight from that, and if you like it would be unfair, I think, to characterize the perspective of like the Doom radio or some of that other stuff, people, as just being about that. But it is a general like principle or ideal that is espoused commonly, and it's a common thing also in the game industry. And it's a thing that's kind of seen as a mark of professionalism rather than amateurism, amateurishness. But I think it's kind of can be really misguided too, because it depends on the sort of metric which you're evaluating a game's value or worth with. It's easier to sort of automate and kind of measure things like flow, which is maybe why they're so, you can get it down to a science. It's not one of those things that's like kind of thrown up to the gods and like, you know, completely dependent on someone's kind of ineffable artistic ability. But it's easier to kind of advertise to like producers or somebody, you know, this is what we're gonna do to help the players like stay with our game and play it for longer, and how we're gonna get more money, etc., etc. Or justify charging the prices that huge games are. But I don't think it's like impossible to get like artistic decisions down to a little bit of a science anyway, even if it's up like a lot of it is kind of hard to pin down. But I don't know, at the end of the day, like, a map is streamlined, it has some kind of cool themes in it, it's abstract, there's good combat interactions or whatever, that's fine. You know, it engages you moment to moment if you're playing it kind of for that, as a kind of more of a distraction and less of something that you need to actively really focus on the environment and the construction of it. I think there's a lot of effort made into those being more or less invisible, whereas this, you know, puts it at the forefront. The environment makes you pay attention to it. It isn't kind of a dressing. I don't want to, like, you know, say that that kind of experience is invalid, but that kind of experience is so dominantly favored as the kind of superior one, and that's why it's always so frustrating to me. Because if you do want, I don't know, I think it goes back to, like, why I recently kind of was like, I don't like saying that I was quitting video games. And, you know, I do think I want to spend more time on other things. I still have my Patreon and etc. So it's, I feel the need to do some of this stuff partly for that reason. But I think it's just kind of sad. Like, I don't know what else to say about it after all these years. It hasn't been that long. After, like, the last few years of feeling like pushing this idea of, like, narrative and more coherent spaces and just, like, actually telling a story through these things, like, it's not, like, the amount of influence or whatever that I'm gonna have is very limited. And the culture is, like, so dominantly about the kind of things that you can measure, like measurable outcomes and everything like that, that it's really hard to find a comfortable space where you can, like, niche or something where you can be about the more kind of artistic side. Because, like, I don't know, to some extent, I'm also not always a fan of, like, quote-unquote walking simulators, if they don't have interesting stuff going on in them. And there are a lot of, like, indie games and things like that that are pretty underbaked as far as the experience goes. Although, I don't know, at the end of the day, I might prefer, I guess it depends, because I have played a lot of, like, half-baked indie games that really annoy me. Just doing, like, judging and all that kind of stuff. But, for the IGF, I don't know, I think, like, it's hard to cultivate that space that's more about kind of ineffable, abstract. There's not a lot of, like, things that you can turn to, and the fan culture and things like that are so dominant that it's just hard to find any kind of place within game culture that feels super healthy to me. And then you add to that, like, the expectation that you really, if you're a games person, then you're throwing yourself completely into it, like, that's your thing. You can't really be a complex person because games are inherently supposedly the superior creative form, so if you do game stuff, then that's your identity. And yeah, that's, like, when I have no kind of ability to exercise, like, you know, if I'm not coming in as an outsider who has a lot of other, is a different background and, you know, can kind of view these things with a more clear head, then it's hard to, like, feel comfortable being in that space and being somebody who's supposed to be there and, you know, like, fix the system from within or something like that. I don't know. I was talking to somebody about that recently just because that was an idea that I was very against for a long time, the whole fixing the system from within. And then I feel like I've made the exact same arguments, like, oh, these people just need to see blah blah blah, and you know. But there is a part of me that's very cynical and thinks, like, okay, that's probably not going to happen. But I don't know. I mean, I still have certainly plenty of hope for things. I've played a fair number of new games, and there's some interesting things coming out. Maybe not as interesting as I'd like them to be, but, you know, like... I don't know. Interesting is obviously subjective, but just like, I don't think there are too many people experimenting outside the realm of like commercial accessibility, because that would, once you start implicating the players in what they're doing, then it kind of goes outside the realm of like a consumer provider, a consumer distributor, whatever relationship, and it's hard to, I don't know, you start to implicate people so much of the culture that you're supposedly part of, and you're like making something within, and in the realm of like AAA games, it's pretty much impossible to do that. There are so many elements and overseers and things like that are controlling the, like, what you make and what kind of stuff, you know, not only just explicit things, but implicitly. And I think that implicit control is like also, you know, makes its way into indie games, especially commercial indie stuff, because you still, you might be able to theoretically make whatever you want to make, but you're still being, you know, defined by all these market forces if you're not making free stuff. And, you know, you still have to go through these distribution channels, and for it to be really worth your time and for you to make quite a bit of money, you either have to get super lucky or, you know, appeal to a fairly broad mass audience, which means adopting genres or ideas that are very game popular. And for a lot of people, you know, if that's the culture that they know, then it's like second nature. But it is like an implicit kind of rule that is being imposed that a lot of people aren't even aware that they're participating in. I like this little area. I have to get the blue key to get there. I don't know. I don't want to like talk overwhelmingly about this map, because you get so much of the feeling of it from just watching the play of it, you know. So it's kind of like, I don't even know what I can say. But yeah, commercial indie games still go through that same thing. And, you know, I know a lot of people who are really struggling to make a lot of money from stuff. And I think, I don't know, I certainly don't think that people are going to stop making games, or that the whole indie apocalypse thing is really true. I like that view. I'm going to be at the other side of that shortly. But on the other hand, like, yeah, it is maybe harder to, the marketplace is huge. It's maybe harder to distinguish yourself, and a lot of what is, you know, really distinguishes it for people are like production values. And I like that I went to so much effort to avoid that fucking homing rocket and then got hit in the face with something else. A lot of what it's about now as far as distinguishing yourself is production values, which means, you know, that's more money and time put into something, which means less money you get back from something. So I don't, it feels less and less like a really sane, sustainable thing to do. And you know that, of course, like that's not necessarily a tragedy. Like game tools are accessible and out there, and if you want to make something free, then you still can. And you know, selling your thing or whatever isn't the end of the world. Like you can still do stuff artistically, but just finding the right channels to like get your thing noticed and everything like that is still really difficult, and there's still a lot of stuff out there. So, and you know, if it doesn't meet with what a lot of people in that particular culture are interested in, then it'll probably get dismissed, because it's just like, you know, people aren't gonna spend super a lot of time with a particular thing if it isn't giving them what they want. So I guess that's just the idea of like content on the internet in general, is how oriented it is towards giving people what they want and how little like space there is for people to be challenged. I don't know. You can make that argument into infinity, but at the end of the day, people are gonna do what they wanna do, and that's the kind of sad thing for me. And that's why it's like easier for me to say like, okay. Sorry, been eating almonds again. That's the sad thing for me, is that, you know, they're really, it's, you're kind of up against something that's a lot bigger than you. Man, I really like this area. I think that's Spider Mastermind on the far end, and I think there's also, there's definitely a Cyber Demon. I'm doing that so that I can take a screenshot of it without my weapon being... I like that the spider demon is trying to shoot at me, but I think I'm too far away from it. There's a bunch of rockets that fly by me. I also like the touch of the blood coming out of those mouths in the fountain where I'm at right now. That's like a texture that he put over the default texture. It's just a little sector. You can see it up close that it's a sector. Okay, I really eat it in this area. This is like the Doom 2 gotcha scenario where you're just supposed to make the bosses infight. And I don't really know what I'm trying to do with the switches, but there's an area that I can just go to that activates one of the switch things to go up, which is, I'm trying to activate one of the things to go up so that I can run across the platform, because I know that's what I need to do. But I'm just supposed to run across, or I'm just supposed to run down that hallway first before that activates. Also, it's totally possible to get stuck in this pit here, or at least it might not be. I don't know. I did anyway. But yeah, I'm going to be here for a while, because I didn't figure that out right away. It's kind of easy to assume things are going to happen in a certain way. Like, you know, you play through something and then you forget details. So you're like, oh, okay, I'm here now, so I should do this. And then you forgot that you did like one other thing before you did that. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I actually met when I was at IndieCade. So I was at IndieCade, which is in L.A., and this guy Matt Tropiano was there promoting Adventures of Square, which is a Doom, it's its own game, but it's made in the Doom engine. It obviously plays like Doom. It has its own kind of art style, and he submitted it to IndieCade but didn't get in. But IndieCade does give you a pass, and it's made by Jimmy, who's I think UK based, and some other people. And he came up to this other guy that I know, who's a UK indie, and they were talking about Jerry Mickle, who's another indie and also does Doom stuff. And I was confused for a second. He's like, "Oh, I'm from the Doom community." I was like, "Wow." It was really funny because I've met like John Romero and some other people because of going to so many game events and everything. But people from the Doom community is pretty small and insular, so it's people who have day jobs and are doing other things in their life. So it was really cool to actually meet somebody and talk about stuff. Like, obviously, I'm not super involved in the Doom community, but I've been following it for years. I've been following it since, like, 1998, you know? And part of me, it feels like, you know, as... there's something about, despite all my problems with, like, you know, the usual level design dogma and all that kind of stuff, there's something that feels very nice about the fact that that community has been around and at least somewhat stable for that long of a time. And it's always just been a hobby. It's always just been something that people have done on the side. And it's not something that they had to give up because of, like, career or whatever. It might be something that they didn't do for years and then came back to or whatever. But whereas, like, the indie stuff feels so much, like, kind of fickle and gold rush-y in terms of the mentality. So, I don't know. My attitude was kind of like, oh, yeah, hell yeah. I might be quitting quitting game stuff, but I still plan to, like actually explore making Doom maps and stuff, because it's been so much part of my life for so long. And I don't know, it felt nice to just be able to say that. Because, you know, at the end of the day, I don't know, I still check out a lot of Doom stuff, and it's something that is, like, weirdly comforting for me to turn off the sound and just, like, listen to whatever albums or whatever that I want to listen to and then just play through stuff. And I usually am a lot more relaxed than I am on these playthroughs, and, you know, I can save anywhere, so whatever. I don't mind, like, dealing with hard shit if I can save anywhere, because I'm not, like, super hardcore about it. I don't know, it feels nice. I think, like, the problem with so many of these communities, which is not necessarily a problem, it may be a protective mechanism or something, that is, like, indie games, really all online communities, like, I'm eating an almond. Yeah, really all online communities that I've kind of joined, more or less, but like the chiptune community, chiptune tracker community, stuff like that, there is a lot of insularity and a lot of, like, people making stuff towards other people in that community, and it's hard to be able to translate that to outsiders. And I don't know whether that's necessarily always a bad thing, but I mean I would, like, again argue that sometimes people don't spend enough time developing their own styles, or, like, you know, and are too much focused on this idea of professionalism or something, which is actually still very insular. And by, like, keeping your uniqueness or whatever, you might actually make your experience more accessible to outsiders, because it's easier to distinguish it from, it's easier to see it as being its own thing rather than something that you need to be able to follow a community to understand. Like, I showed one of my friends who was an art major in school some of Inkrapara's games, and he you know, and he got it, like, you didn't really need context outside of the, like, outside of maybe a few basic gameplay things to really understand what was going on. And I couldn't say that about a lot of, like, game things that are really popular in game culture, so. I don't know how you solve the problem of hyper-insularity. Because obviously, like, I don't know, any community is going to have that problem of having its own dynamics and kind of favored ideals. But if you don't have the support of the community, like, having the support of a community, it really helps. Like, it's something that I've really desired because I don't, you know, I didn't have, like, a friends in real life or parents who really could, like, have, like, understand or really encourage me actively on this stuff. So, you know, and I always thought that Doom modding was, like, seen as super dorky, which it, I mean, it presumably is, but I'm not as bothered by that now because I, like, you know, super dorky stuff has become more or less mainstream anyway. But yeah, I don't know how you answer that. I like this flame cavern part. I've already been down there just to teleport back up, but I'm gonna go down there briefly again. And I like how the layout of it is. Yeah, I finally got the blue key here. I like how the layout of it is. You just have to hit a switch right at the beginning. And then go back through the teleporter, which can be pretty confusing because it seems like you need to go further. But the only reason that the other platforms are there are just to get you to get the Megasphere if you want it. But I like that idea of just spitting you into an area that's, like, a little bit bigger, and then spitting you back out. And that's all you really need to do. But you can explore it a little bit more if you want to. Yeah, I don't know how you solve the insularity problem. I mean, obviously, Doom is a hard enough game to play, so, you know, whatever. Part of it is just, like, maybe to be able to say, like, just the achievement of making something really bizarre and unique and artistic in something like a Doom engine is itself in itself interesting. Or in kind of any kind of, like, bare bones video game context. And I don't know, like, increasingly, yeah, see, we're going back to the flame area now. Increasingly, like, everything is splintering so much, so I don't really even know what the idea of, like, mainstream exposure or whatever means anymore. But I guess, just, you know, personally, it is frustrating to me that there isn't more emphasis on developing a sense of uniqueness. Yeah, I like how this area, it, it, there's so much, there's, like, a lot of lava areas, but this is the only area that kind of expands on that, and it expands on it just enough, so it doesn't really make you go through it a lot, it's just there, more of, like, an interlude or something. He doesn't try and make it super bloated to the point where you have to explore, like, a huge lava area, too. Because I think that would kind of ruin the impact of this map. I cheated there because I didn't want to go back in the pit. I jumped. Yeah. I don't know. I've said the same thing a billion times across all these videos, so it's kind of preaching to the choir at this point. But I hope you enjoyed. I hope you've enjoyed this series. And yeah, I don't know what else to say about it really. I hope that, you know, part of it goes back to the internet being so corporately controlled by so many different forces. And I hope that some of the energy and whatever that's been invested in online activism and stuff is directed towards more towards art and like building something different, alternative, outside of the mainstream, not just alternative in the way that it's like small or personal, but like radically alternative, just completely challenging the ethos and mindset of what we're used to, because there's just so much media out there that we consume, and so much of it is like at the end of the day not necessarily super enriching. So I don't know the answer to that. So yeah, I finished the map. I only got 20% secret. Still plenty of kills too, so I missed quite a few areas. This is just the end part here, which is just like their sort of symbol, the symbol for sacrament. I hope you enjoyed this video. I'm also going to try and do a video of his level, map 23 from alt, so I hope you have a good day.